Welcome to the heart of the matter. Today we will be continuing from our previous episode where we talked about fertility and the modern methods for conception. We have a guest with us, Mrs. Toyin Lolu-Ogunmade, who's going to be sharing her 13-year journey to conception. Good morning, Mrs. Ogunmade. Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much.
Yes, could you please share with us your briefly your journey up until the 12th year, the 10th year, when you discovered you were had challenges with fertility?
Okay, I got married in August 1999, and I felt it would be very easy conceiving, so I wasn't really bothered when. I wanted to stay away from having children for a year and then try, you know, after a year. So I wasn't really bothered. By the year 2000, I said, okay, I'm ready for this. And then it didn't happen. And along the way, I discovered I had fibroids. And it was a really, really horrid time because I had episodes of bleeding, I had episodes of constant pain during my menstrual cycles. I would go on and on bleeding, I would be in pain, I would have to go to the hospital every time to take pain shots. It was a horrid time, and it went on for like 6 years. By the time it was the fourth year, it had become like a daily thing. I couldn't sit through an hour, I would be soaked through. And I decided that I couldn't do it anymore, that I was going through surgery. Now, all the while in the 6 year period, a doctor had told me the fibroids were in no way hindering conception and that there was nothing, you know, disturbing my ability to conceive naturally. So I went through all the tests, HSG, to determine whether my womb was okay enough to carry a child. That's a very painful test. I went through all the tests, hormonal assays, just to be sure what was going on. But it was just that fibroid thing. And from all the scans I did, they will show sometimes two, sometimes three. The worst I had was, okay, you had like four. But when the bleeding didn't, bleeding became so heavy during my periods, I became concerned. I would go on bleeding, I would feel like fainting. So I decided, okay, this must stop. And I chose to have surgery. Initially, my husband wasn't supportive of that surgery because it was like the doctors had told us, you know, the fibroids were not in any way hindering. So it was, why do you want to do a surgery? So I said, well, I can't continue with this pain and with the blood loss. It was just too much. And by February 2006, I went into the theater and I had a myomectomy to remove the fibroids. I thought they were like three, four. To my shock, after the surgery, they removed 22.
Wow, 22 fibroids.
Yes. When I had an epidural, so I didn't sleep throughout the 3 hour surgery, and I could hear them count one, two. I was like, oh no, I'm sure they're counting something else. So by the time the nurse came to me and said, Ms. Ogunmade, you had many. I said, let me see them. My mom was, why do you want to see them? I said, I want to see them. I want to see these things that have been disturbing me. So they brought them and I counted myself, and they were 22, you know. So after that surgery, I felt a bit of relief. I said, okay, yeah, so they were actually disturbing. Let's go ahead with this conception thing. And then it didn't happen again. But then something now happened to me. I discovered that I kept discharging, and on a daily basis, they were becoming profuse to the extent that I had to wear sanitary towels. And this was like 8 weeks after the surgery. So I thought, what's going on here? And from clear discharge, it became smelly, reddish, and I had to wear sanitary towels. And I had to do that for a year. after the surgery.
So what did you do next?
For a year after that, I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what I was doing wrong. I felt I was doing all the right things. I had gone to the hospital, they had run tests, I had gone through HSG tests like 2 times. And I just didn't know what else to do. It never just occurred to me that there could be more.
You know? You went back to the hospital?
So, one day a friend of mine said, "You don't look like somebody that wants a child. Why don't you go back to the hospital?" And I said, "What have I been doing for 9 years, for, you know, all that while?" And it now became like an issue for me. It was now an issue. I didn't have rest in my mind anymore. So I told my husband one day, I said, "Look, I think I want to go back to the hospital." And he said, "So what have you been doing? Is it God talking to you that you should go back to the hospital?" I said, "I don't know if it's God, excuse me, but something in my mind is telling me, go back to the hospital, go and check, something is wrong." And it took us a year, it took him a year to agree. Because he's Christian, he felt God can do it. He was trusting that the Lord would do it naturally, that we would conceive naturally, we wouldn't have to go back to the hospital for anything. But
so when you got to the hospital?
When I got to the hospital, I had to go through some tests again, the painful HSG again. In HSG, what they do is they push in a non-toxic dye through the woman's private, you know, through the tubes, and then to get to see what the uterus is like, whether the tubes are competent, whether there are issues, whether there's any blockage, whether the uterus is, you know, okay enough to carry a child. So that's what that test does. And it's extremely painful. And it's embarrassing. You know, I didn't want to do it again, but I had to. And when I got the results, I didn't make sense out of it. So I went to a gynecologist that had sent me for the test. And when the man saw the X-ray and the report, he was in shock. He froze. And he asked me, he said, "Tony, what happened to you?" I said, "What do you mean, what happened to me?" He said, "What did you do to yourself?" I said, "What do you mean, what did I do to myself?" You know, because I didn't understand. And he said, "You have additions." And I said, "What do you mean by additions?" So he now said, "What exactly happened?" So I told him I had a surgery at one point in time. And, you know, all that experience. And he said to me, "You have too much scarring in your womb. Your womb is glued together." I didn't understand. So he showed me what the uterus looks like and what the normal uterus should look like and what this damage had, you know, caused. It was basically like crumpling tissue paper. It was so bad that the dye they tried to push in could not go through. So it was like it was completely sealed here, not blocked, glued together. Additions are bands, you know, they glue together. So I said, "What's next for me?" And said, "Surrogacy."
What is surrogacy?
There are 2 types of surrogacy. And the kind of surrogacy that the doctor explained, it's a gestational surrogacy where they will get viable eggs from the woman and they will get sperm from the man, fertilize in the laboratory. That's what in vitro means. That means it's outside your body. And then they transfer back into the womb, but this time into another woman. You know, it's a complex science, but it's available, it's done. The other type of surrogacy is stimulating the carrier to use our own eggs. You know, but because the doctor felt I had chances of you know, having viable eggs, that he said, okay, going for gestational surrogacy. And I was like, doctor, I don't want a surrogate. I want to be able to carry a child. I'm a woman. Mm. I want to have that experience. And I practically begged him to go, you know, to book me in for surgery again. And he said to me that really he doesn't want to do it. But if that is my option, then he will book me for surgery again. But he won't be the one that will do it. He will call in another doctor. And at this time, it will be a lot more invasive. At that point, I became scared. I was afraid. I was afraid, I've been going into the theater several times. I was afraid something would go wrong. I might die. I might lose my life in this process. So I thought, I need to get another option. Maybe there's something. God has promised me I'll have children. So I decided I would go abroad.
Okay.
And seek alternative options, whether there's still a solution somewhere. So in March of 2010, my husband and I left for India. Okay. How we got to India, that's another story for another day. And when the doctor examined me, he said, sorry, Toyin, this cannot work. You can't use your uterus. You need to get a surrogate.
Okay.
I said, why? He said, there's too much damage. That if I ever get pregnant, if by chance I ever get pregnant and an embryo implants, most likely my uterus will tear up in the process and I'll lose my life. And I wasn't prepared to die. You know, I feel I have too many things to do to achieve. So I said, doctor, if that's my alternative, let's look for a surrogate. I was in India. So I said, assure me that these children won't take any genetic matter, you know, from a surrogate. And he said, no, it's gestational surrogacy.
Okay.
We'll use your eggs, we'll use your husband's sperm, and genetically the children will be yours. So
at this point, you had chosen a surrogate
I had
carrier,
chosen a surrogate carrier, and I started the IVF process. Okay. They brought the eggs out.
Mm-hmm.
And they transferred, and the first one didn't work. I was like, so what happened again? I felt it was automatic.
Mm.
This is a young girl, she's 27, she has two children, so what could happen, you know? But it didn't work, it failed. And I said, okay, we go again, we try again, but it was a very painful process.
Mm.
I went into complications called hyperstimulation. Don't let me go into all of that. So in between, because when you go through an IVF cycle and they remove the egg, they remove it under anesthesia. It's very painful. And the doctors will allow you rest for like 2 months so that the ovaries can go back. The ovaries get swollen and all that. So in between that period of rest, I went into the theater again. I went in for surgery, trying to correct, you know, the damage that was done in my uterus. I was still hopeful, you know. I wanted to try to carry it by myself. So I tried, I went into surgery again.
Wow.
That was the third time in a year. And this time around, it was a 4.5 hour surgery. And by the time I came out of it, the doctor told me, no, it can't work, it failed. That there was no way on earth I would ever get pregnant by myself. I can't carry a child by myself. At that time on the hospital bed, alone, away from family, the reality dawned on me a little bit, and it was a painful time. My husband couldn't come in at that time for that surgery because visa issues. He had come twice and left, you know, so I was alone in the hospital. There were other Nigerian women in that hospital. We were 12 Nigerian women in that hospital in India looking for children. It's that bad. You know, I decided I wasn't going to give up. That everything medicine is telling me is your womb is dead. You can't have a child. You can't carry a child. And to make it worse, when they brought out the eggs, they were, oh, you're getting old, your eggs are getting old, you know, your chances are getting slimmer. So everything around me looked like a dead situation. But I decided to fight. I wanted life for my children. I decided I would choose life. Okay. And embrace whatever options I have.
So you tried a surrogacy?
So I tried a second time. Okay. I went through IVF a second time. We chose another surrogate, a younger one again. I remember there was a surrogate mother that was on treatment and she ran away. It's also a tough one on them. So after like how many attempts, okay, we finally got a surrogate that will stay. And we went in for the second procedure. They got plenty eggs again, fertilized, and it failed. At that point, I was devastated. I was just ready to die. I was heartbroken completely. And the doctor was, consider donor eggs. I said, consider donor eggs. I can't carry my own child. I'll now use a donor egg. So why am I a woman? I felt incomplete. I felt like a failure. I had been quite successful in every other thing I do. I had a budding career. But this was looking at me in the face like a failure, that you can never overcome this. And that second one devastated me completely. I went into depression, more or less. And for like a week, I was just like, I was like a zombie. You know, I was like a zombie. And eventually when I pulled out, I couldn't pray. I couldn't read the Bible anymore. I was in a state of, I was like a zombie, that's the word. And I asked my husband to come back from Nigeria. He had gone. I said, please come, I need to see you. For me, I just needed to see him. I needed to hold him. Say, okay, you are still alive. Nothing has happened to you. I still have you, even if I don't have a child. So he came. He came to India. And the doctor said, okay, you are going to go through some tests, some genetic tests. Let's see whether something is wrong with your chromosomes. Let's see whether you can, you know. So we went through all sorts of tests. Before we did a third one, I spoke with my pastor. And I said, I'm almost giving up. I want to change my hospital. And he encouraged me, said, no, stay there. We'll trust God that this will be successful. And I stayed. And I said, God, I'm not the only one in this. My pastor is also involved in this. So you have to make this work. And I'm trusting. So we tried again, another surrogate this time. And we got good eggs. They did very well, good quality embryos, and the doctor transferred 4 embryos. And she conceived quadruplets. So when we ran the tests, and the doctor said, Toyin, congratulations, your surrogate is pregnant. I was like, ah, at last, you know? And he said, you're not excited. I said, no. I just want God to keep this one. You know, so I switched, immediately I switched from hoping to get pregnant to God, finally she's pregnant. Please hold this one. See us through this process, you know, so that at the end of the day, we'll have our children. And 8 months.
Successful.
Yeah. Initially we had a quadruplet pregnancy. But later on, like 10 weeks into the pregnancy, we lost 2 of them. And 8 months down the line, we had a girl and a boy, you know, set of twins. They are 2 years old now.
Congratulations.
And thank you. And it's made the whole journey so worthwhile. And for me, that confirms the fact that when you have a gestational surrogate, the babies don't take anything from her. They are genetically not connected to her. They only need, because babies can't survive outside the womb, so they only need her womb to keep them for the 9 months journey.
So they're 100%?
They're 100% mine. Being in the hospital for 2 years, going through all of that, it was an expensive journey. Going through IVF 3 times, using surrogates. My surrogate stayed in the hospital all through the 8 months she was there. So it was expensive. But the Lord provided. The Lord met our needs. I got to know another part of God. I have a tendency to be self-sufficient, self-reliant. I've always worked. I've never had issues getting a job, you know. And I've always believed I can take care of myself. I can meet my own needs. But I learned how to rely on God. Because throughout, from the moment I started all those surgeries in 2009 till the period I came back with the twins, I was out of work. So I was out of work for like 3 years. And I knew how it is to be in need and then going through expensive treatment. So when all of those blessings came in form of monetary gifts, a lot of them even without asking people, somebody sponsored a flight twice. Paid for a ticket, you know. Even without asking, people gave. So I learned a new thing.
At any time through the whole process, from 10 years to the 13th year, did this consume you? Was it an obsession?
At a point, yes. Yes, in the early years of my marriage. Initially, it didn't bother me because I didn't want to have children early. You know, at least for 1 year.
How did you overcome this obsession?
One, my husband, I mentioned earlier, is one of a kind. He protected me from myself. He calmed me down. He was like, I married you for yourself. I didn't marry you to have children. So even if you can't have children for me, that's no big deal. I still love you. It doesn't change who you are to me. You know, so he helped me. You know, and then the Lord himself had to basically stop that obsession. Because he said to me one day when I was worshiping and a song came up and I said, Lord, you are my redeemer. I know you can redeem time for me. And in between my prayers, he interrupted me and said, if I don't give you this child you want, will I still be God to you? Will I still be your Lord? And for a minute, I sat back and I thought through it. And I said, whose name is at stake? Everybody knows me as a Christian. I've been born again since age 19. Everybody knows me as a Christian. So I said, if I can't have a child, whose name is at stake? It's yours. So I said, Lord, you are able. You are my Lord. Even if you choose to slay me, you are still Lord. I'll still serve you.
What are you doing to help other women that may be facing similar challenges?
Right now, what I do is run a support group for intending parents that are going through this experience, and then maintain an active blog site, what to do. I counsel women. I tell them what to do. There are hospitals that I know of that are credible, that I refer them to. And I've seen some of them come back with their children, so it's rewarding. In future, I would like to raise funds to help couples that cannot afford, that genuinely cannot afford.
We're out of time now, but on a final note, what advice would you have for any of our viewers that are watching this at the moment?
I would say don't give up. Choose life. Because for me, it was a matter of life and death. There was a death situation. And I wanted to choose life for my children. So I'll say choose life. As Christians, we must be wise. God has given doctors the ability to use science to our advantage. That's the way I see it. If you have a headache, you take some tablets. If you have a defective eyesight, you wear glasses. So if you can't have a child naturally, why wouldn't you go for medical help? So people tell me, why this? I say, God told me to go back to the hospital. And they find it strange. For some people, their own miracle happened in another way. But I'll say, don't ignore the hospital.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Ogunmade. You're a very brave woman. Thank you so much for sharing your story. And I'm sure our viewers are touched, and I'm sure we'll get a lot of feedback and even testimonies.
Amen.
Thank you very much for watching The Heart of the Matter. We're sure you've been inspired by Mrs. Ogunmade's story. We would like to hear from you, so please send us any questions or comments or stories you may want to share. Until next week, stay blessed.